Next, we have women who mapped the change with V. Sriram in conversation with Anita Ratnam. They're already on stage, as you can see, so I will hand it over to V. Sriram, sir.
Our session is titled Women Who Mapped the Change. What with social turmoil, political upheavals, and cultural turbulence, India in the early 20th century was a compelling and ever-changing kaleidoscope of headline-making events. While most eyeballs were focused on the rapid momentum of the independence movement, there were a significant number of women who were also making history, or shall we say, herstory. These damsels used their wits, willpower, and other weaponry from courage to guile to plain garden-variety impudence to make their names in this city and beyond. These uppity women were busy blasting holes in the status quo. Brainy educators, feisty doctors, passionate anti-notch crusaders, pioneering accountants, angelic assassins. Yes, Madras had them all. For this discussion, we've selected women who were born at the turn of the 20th century. Their work and resonating influence had ripple effects for many decades forward. There were so many names to choose from, as you well might imagine. But one thing Sriram and I decided is we would not focus on performing artists, because that itself would be several sessions. So what we have done is we've chosen six main women who were remarkable on their own, but who also displayed deft management skills in the patriarchy and how they managed their men. Now, as the discussion gains momentum, some other names may dovetail in and out of the conversation. First, let me welcome Sriram.
Thank you.
I call him Chennai's historian Talaivar. He's a raconteur, a diarist. His walking tours are sold out like rock concert stampedes. His social media updates are eagerly awaited every December season under the hashtag SeasonVomboids. He has wry and an unerring eye to pick out all the foibles in the most unexpected places. He is, in my eyes, through social media, Sarva Vyapi. He really is everywhere. Sriram, let's begin. We said no performing artists, but I have to begin with one very well-known name who's part of dance history. She was not a performing artist, but she belonged to the courtesan community, Dr. Muthu Lakshmi Reddy.
So that's actually a very good name to start with, because two women, in my opinion, Muthu Lakshmi Reddy in the performing arts and Sister Subbalakshmi in the non-performing space, these two women are kind of taken for granted. And it is from them that you really have the bulk of the social reform movement with women coming in. But Muthu Lakshmi, yes, because she came from the courtesan community, born to Chandramma of Pudukota and Narayanayyar, and then later, you know, wanting to study in the school. But the Maharaja's college over there, the boys, you know, the parents of the boys feel that having the daughter of a Devadasi as a student would corrupt the high principles and morals of the boy students. So then the Maharaja has to pass legislation to get her into the college. Having studied there, then comes to Madras Medical College. Having studied here, goes back to Pudukottai to practice. And then the mother is naturally very anxious, you know, you have to get married. And she says, I will get married only if the man is prepared to finish whatever he is doing elsewhere and come and settle in Pudukottai with me. So this boondocks of a place. And then suddenly you have Dr. Sundara Reddy coming all the way from Madras, giving up a lucrative practice, willing to settle down with her, and then getting married to him. And the diary note on the day of the marriage, he agreed to abide by all my wishes and never cross my path. This was the condition under which he married her and then brought her to Madras. And of course, the rest is history, as
and
we all know.
An interesting prenup.
That's right. First instance of a prenup.
She's known, of course, in dance history as being up front as an anti-notch crusader. And but we also have another name, not as well known.
Yeah, that is Moovallur Ramamritam Ammal. Yes. See, when I wrote my book on Bangalore Nagaratnama, I wish I had read the biography of Moovallur Ramamritam Ammal, because it came to me later. And that biography kind of indicates the terrible conditions in which the Devadasi women really lived. So it's very easy to become an apologist today and say that Devadasis were women of God and they were mystic and they were wonderful and beautiful and they knew how to sing and dance and they came from a very high level. But here you have Moovallur Ramamritam Ammal, who depicts what the life of the Devadasis really was. So at the age of 5, the father vanishes because he is unable to bring up this girl. And then sends a letter to the mother saying that I have now found employment in Madras. You abandon the child there and you come away. So at the age of 5, she is sold by the grandmother to a practicing Devadasi. So, you know, today we talk about these things about children, women, girl children being sold. But then also even Vasanta Kumari's mother, for that matter, was sold from a Brahmin family to a Devadasi family. So the same thing. So in this case, the girl is sold at the age of 5. And then all the Gajya Puja, and then that, what is it called? Dandiyam Pidikirdi, which is highly phallic in my opinion. You put an olakkai in the middle and get the girl to hold on to it and then say she is now initiated into the world of Devadasi system. And then, you know, at the age of 10 or 11, she is asked to kind of cohabit with a man who is 65. And he is the patron who wants to come and perform what is known as the deflowering ceremony. But at that stage, she protests and decides to marry the Natuvanar, because he is a man, Swayambulingam Pillai, who is willing to offer her a decent life and the cloak of marriage. And so, you know, long before Seer Thiruthal Thirumanam became famous in the Dravidian movement, Moovallur Ramamritam Ammal did it. You know what she does? They both go to the temple, they light a lamp and they declare that we are husband and wife henceforth. No priest, nothing. There is one elder who comes along and who stays there, and he kind of says, yes, I am the witness to this marriage. That's about it. In 1925, even before Muthulakshmi Reddy has filed the anti-Notch bill in the Madras legislative, 2 years before that. And then from then on, when Dr. Muthulakshmi Reddy begins her campaign against the Notch practices, this lady goes forth and goes from village to village campaigning about how evil the Devadasi system was, and was supported by people like T.N. Rajaratnam Pillai, went on to write books. In fact, in 1936, she writes a book called Madimosa Kalanjiyam or Devadasi in Mosavalai or Madipetra Minor, which is about how two conniving Devadasis try to cheat a minor of all his wealth, and the minor kind of wakes up at the end of the day and realizes that this is not the life that he ought to be leading. And then, of course, joins Periyar in his self-respect movement. And then when Anna breaks away from Periyar, becomes part of the DMK, joins DMK along with Anna, remains a lifelong champion of the lower classes, and most significantly in a particular village where Dalits were not allowed to wear dhotis and only appear in a loincloth, campaigned for them for the dignity of their being allowed to wear the dhoti and come out in public. So this is the kind of life that Moovallur Ramamritam Ammal lived. Then there was Sai Mata Sivabrinda Devi, who came from the Thirugokarnam community of Dasis, who opted to become a godwoman rather than continue in the practice of becoming a Devadasi. And all her sisters took to playing the mridangam, because then they would not have to dance on stage. So this is the kind of change that they were bringing about in their own time.
And you're talking about in the 1920s.
That's right.
I will tell you a little incident. I did my Arangetram, I was age 9, in the mid-60s. And it was at my mama's reception in Abbotsbury, the then Kalyana Mandapam. And I remember my grandfather coming backstage. He did not hug me, and here I'm a 9-year-old. He said loudly to my mother, Anita has to stop dancing. Nobody will marry her, and it'll bring a bad name to our family.
So this was in the 1960s.
So the ripple effects are something that I still remember very clearly, because it was a moment of both shock and hurt. So if I'm talking of the 60s, I can imagine how devastated and how devastating the social climate must have been in the 20s that you're discussing. So one became an ascetic, one became an atheist, and one became an activist.
That's right.
Yes. So now we're moving on to the social reform sector. And as this conversation goes on, maybe this is going to jog the memory of many of you, you may have had some remarkable women in your own family, and you may be trying to excavate, like archaeologists, stories that your grandmothers and great-grandmothers shared with you. But a lot of these women refused to be sandpapered into submissive, bland uniformity. And so we come to Ambujammal.
This, as she said, you know, this was a different social strata altogether in which Ambujammal was living. Ambujammal's father was the Advocate General, Government of Madras. They lived in a house that was 150 grounds in Luz. So 360,000 square feet of area in which a family of five was living. And in the midst of all this, Ambujammal gets married to a man who comes straight from Kumbakonam, Desikacharyar, and probably lived in one of those street houses where they observed menstruation, women isolation, widowhood, everything. And then he suddenly lands up in this house of 360,000 square feet and promptly has a nervous breakdown. So Ambujammal's biography, Nankanda Bharatam, has only contempt for her husband's family. Because she comes from this rarefied strata of society where the governor is coming every alternate day to have tiffin in the house. If he doesn't come, Mahatma Gandhi is coming to stay. That kind of a household, and she is married to this character who is like from the back of beyond. So she says, "Yen kanavar buddhi swadinam illamal ahivittar." So this is the... And to top it all, the mother-in-law dies in Kumbakonam. So Ambujammal goes to observe the 10-day condolences in Kumbakonam along with the husband. And her father says, look, you'll never be able to adjust in that milieu, don't go. But she says, no, this is what is expected of me, I have to go. So she goes along there, and then the husband goes to his parents' house. She goes and stays in an aunt's house. And every day in the morning, in a jhatka vandi, she is sent from the aunt's house to the husband's house to observe the obsequies. And there, you know, the sisters-in-law bathing and then cooking in wet clothes. Right in the morning. Now, she cannot bathe early in the morning. She cannot be in wet clothes. And she cannot cook in veragadupu or anything like that. So, she is standing right at the back. And she writes, in my house, there were servants for doing all these things. I did not even know why these women were up to all this. And then they keep needling her, saying that, you know, you never came when your mother-in-law was alive. But she says, you know, that's none of my business. I hardly knew my mother-in-law in the first place. Then on the 10th day, they tell her that it is customary to go to the river and have a bath. She hasn't ever bathed, because in Madras you have only the Kuvam and the Adyar. You can't bathe in them. So two of the sisters-in-law ceremonially dunk her and then get her out. She gets the flu. And then when she comes back, the 10th day ceremony is over. They tell that all the women of the family will now have to roll in the street mud and beat their breasts and lament. So she stages a walkout immediately and says, that's it. This is, I am never ever going to see my mother-in-law's family again. And comes back to Madras. Now, having come back here, decides that the only salvation in life is to go to prison in the cause of Mahatma Gandhi. And there is already an aunt at home, Janammal, who has left her husband years ago and come away. And so they both decide that we have to go to prison, we have to picket liquor shops. So every day going compulsorily in the morning, picketing liquor shops. But the father is Advocate General, so he's told the police that my daughter is mentally unsound, you can't arrest her. So everybody else gets arrested except Janamma and Ambujammal. So Ambujammal stages a hunger strike at home, saying that unless I am allowed to be imprisoned, I will fast unto death. So the father then says, okay, you can do what you want. So finally, one day, they are arrested in 1931, if I am not mistaken, taken to the Vellore prison, where the jail, the warder comes with a prison badge and puts it on their neck when Janammal tells him, having married one man's Mangal Sutra, we have had enough trouble in life. Now you don't tie another one around our necks, just give it to us. And then they pin it on their blouses and go into prison. And afterwards, when they... See, this is a very interesting period because Ambujammal is in prison, Janammal is in prison, Vaimukode Nayaki Ammal is in prison, Sivabogam Ammal is in prison. All four of them sharing the same prison at the same time between 1931 and 1932. Coming out, they wear the prison badge for every wedding they have to attend as a jewel. Yes. Like a brooch. Yes. Kaidi number so and so. This is what they all preserve till the ends of their remarkable lives. Ambujammal, of course, goes on to become chairman of the Madras Social Welfare Board. Goes on to several other things later in life. But one continuous thread is the fact that I married a non-entity. My aunt gave up life with a non-entity and came back home. I do not deserve to live with this non-entity. I am meant for much bigger things, like Mahatma Gandhi. This was her whole aim in life.
And of course, her father supported her.
Later. Completely. Later. I mean, yeah. He didn't have an option. And then he went along with her right till the end.
But there was a little interesting, she was also associated with the Mylapore Ladies Club.
Egmore Ladies Recreation Club.
Yes.
And see, that we promise not to discuss the arts, but the arts have a terrible tendency of coming into our lives. So she, along with her mother and her grandmother, Lady Bashimayengar, all three are the founders of the Egmore Ladies Recreation Club. So that is where a young girl called Saraswati Bai, who is the first non-Devadasi, is given a performing opportunity in 1908. Or 1909. And that is from the time when the non-Devadasi women take to the performing arts. Now, Saraswati Bai starts performing. Because she starts performing, Bengaluru Nagaratnamma, the prominent Devadasi of her times, thinks that more Brahmin women ought to come in and goes to Vaimukodainayaki's house and says, high time you came to perform. Vaimukodainayaki is probably 15 at that time. And the in-laws are a little reticent. And they don't know, they are rather diffident, and Bengaluru Nagaratnamma says, Na tambura potena yenda tadiyan kelvi kekran paakla. And so she sits and plays the tambura for Vaimuku singing. And that is how the career goes on.
And also, as an aside, you can imagine that this ladies' club must have shocked the rest of the conservative community. They must have thought that these ladies have just been, souls are damned to hell. And my great-grandmother was one of them. So you can imagine a scenario with nine-yard saris and learning to play tennis. And learning how to lift a teacup and holding that pinky finger out. So this was also going on at the same time. Now, Sriram, you've mentioned Godenayaki, named after the poet Saint Andal. Absolutely remarkable life. Multifaceted. Editor, fiction writer, novelist, freedom fighter and everything. So please tell us about her.
Vaimuko, if Ambujamal had absolute contempt for the husband, Vaimuko blossomed because of the husband. Mm. So Vaimu Parthasarathi Iyengar was the man who really encouraged her, he and his mother, the mother-in-law effectively. So they were the people who recognized her talent and that she could tell stories. Now she was illiterate, but she had a remarkable talent for telling stories. So they encouraged her to write her first novel.
Which
because
she
didn't know how to write or read, dictated it to the neighbor.
Yes.
And the neighbor wrote it down and then it went to Vaduvur Dorasami Iyengar, who said that it's a very good novel, we'll publish it. But Vaimuko then learnt how to read and write, went on to buy a magazine that was sinking, it was called Jagan Mohini, resurrected it and became the first woman publisher in Madras Presidency and ran the magazine till the year she died, which was in 1960. Now, right through the time that Vaimuko was in prison also, the magazine kept coming out continuously. And Vaimuko was a great champion for women's rights because in the 1950s, when the Music Academy wanted to give Saraswati Bai the Sangeeta Kalanidhi,
yes,
three men refused to give it to her and kind of blackballed her from getting it. Vaimuko said, so what if this academy is not giving it to you? Let's have a public commemoration for your years of service of Harikatha. And in Triplicane, they had a public meeting and gave her the title Harikatha Kalanidhi. So what if you don't get the Sangeeta Kalanidhi, you're getting the Harikatha Kalanidhi from now on. Vaimuko was not only, as you said, she was a writer, she released gramophone records, yes, and was a crowd puller. She used to warm up the audience before Satyamurthy came and gave his speeches in the Congress party meetings. Also went to prison along with Ambujamal. But I think the character who really stands out in that era, apart from Vaimuko and Ambujamal, of course, we are in Lady Andal school, so we can never forget Lady Andal, child widow, married to Sir M. Mutha Venkat Subbarao as his second wife,
yes,
and then goes on to pioneer reformist movements all over Madras Presidency, a very, very remarkable life. But the other one is Durgabai Deshmukh.
Of course. Yes.
Durgabai, we forget her because she was a non-Tamil, she comes from Andhra and all that. But imagine being born to a well-to-do family, married at the age of 8, and then coming to puberty, tells her father that I am not meant for marriage. I am meant for bigger things in life. And therefore, my husband is most happy, I give him all the freedom to marry someone else. And because nobody is willing to do it, goes and finds a woman to marry her husband. And then the father is dead, so there is no way, the mother is coming to Madras along with that. No, the mother then has to educate the daughter with the two brothers as well. So sells the Mangal Sutra that she had in order to fund her own education and the education of her brothers, then decides to study law and comes to Madras. In the meantime, Mahatma Gandhi is coming to that, wherever they were in Andhra. She wants to meet Mahatma Gandhi. And they tell her that unless you collect 5,000 rupees, you will not be able to meet the Mahatma, which incidentally was not a bribe, but it was a donation to the Congress party. She collects the 5,000 and then goes up to meet Mahatma Gandhi. And then he tells her that when will you learn speaking Hindi? And she says, whenever you learn to speak Telugu, I will learn how to speak Hindi. So this is how the interaction between Mahatma Gandhi and Durgabai starts. Coming to know that a woman is being beaten by her husband regularly in the village, they collect 20 other women whose husbands are beating them regularly, stage a protest march to the places where the husbands work and shame them publicly over there, and extract a promise from them saying that henceforth you will not beat your wife. Finally moves to Madras, studies criminal law in the law college and becomes a criminal lawyer, and then sets up the, you know, the Andhra Mahila Sabha over here. Later on moves to Delhi, falls in love with Sir Chintaman Deshmukh, the most handsome man of his times, as handsome as Jawaharlal Nehru, RBI governor, finance minister. And I'm told that there is a house in Prithviraj Road where on a tree trunk, there is a heart carved with the initials CDDD. I wonder if the tree is still standing. But everybody from Edwina Mountbatten to my wife's grandfather dissuaded Chintaman Deshmukh from marrying Durgabai, saying that you are so good looking, she is, well, not so good looking, let's put it that way. But it was a meeting of hearts. And finally, she wrote their common biography together. It's called Deshmukh and I. And dictated by her to Deshmukh because she was blind by that time. And so he had to write it for her.
That's so moving. Now, all the women that we've discussed so far, they were doing not just one thing, many things, because they said they were jailed together, but they also worked towards advancing the child marriage age. Because,
certainly.
Because they were, some of them, Gode Naika got married when she was 5.
That's right.
So, how successful were they? How much were they able to advance the age?
See, I think for that, we have to go back to Sister Subbalakshmi as well, who was, I think, one of the pioneers in this whole concept of...
As well as widow remarriage.
Widow remarriage and also preventing marriage of children. So, you know, there is this... sister would not have been sister had there not been a Chitti, who was a shaven-headed widow, the mother's sister. And Chitti said that, I am shaven-headed and I cannot wear a blouse because no man can touch me. But every month you expect me to go to a male barber who will shave my head for me. How is it that that is acceptable? So Chitti bought a razor and used to shave her head herself every month. So this was Chitti. Now one day, a widow in the widow's home is seen weeping and Chitti and sister go and ask her, what is it? And she tells her that my younger sister is 8. And she is going to marry a man who is 45 as his 4th wife. And the village marriage is happening somewhere in some town or the other. So what happens is Chitti and sister, they say that we'll go and attend the wedding. So but sister doesn't go, but Chitti goes along with the elder sister of that girl. Now the night before the marriage, the Janavasam is going to happen and everybody has gone out. At that time, Chitti tells the girls, I've got 3 return tickets to Madras. The train leaves in half an hour. Let's go. So they all get into a rickshaw and flee to the railway station. So having come there, in the meantime, the bride's absence has been detected in the marriage pandal and a cousin brother comes rushing to the railway station. The train is about to leave. He boards the compartment, holds on to the bride's hands and is dragging her out. Chitti and the other sister are holding the 2 legs and the train begins to move. And then Chitti tells the younger, the other girl, don't let go. There is a lamppost coming. He's bound to hit his head on it. And that is exactly what happens. The man falls down and they bring the girl back to Madras. This is the way they rescued girls from getting married at the age of 10 and 11. And that is how the whole thing, you know, really got on to such a big movement. Every time I tell this story, something happens to me. You know, I have seen shaven-headed aunts at home. I have seen women who were not allowed to come to weddings. Yo, avalla veena poita. And they were remarkably intelligent women. They knew several languages. They could manage their own finances. Can you imagine that 50% of a country's population is kept in subjugation? These were the people who really fought against it and kind of brought them out of what they were in.
But I still know widows who do not attend weddings. Very forward, very educated, but there is some little karupu pulli there.
Absolutely.
Yes. Now, now all these women, as you said, wore their jail badge as a badge of honor. And here is our next heroine or protagonist, who was one of the early qualified accountants and who challenged the British.
That's right.
Tell us about Shivabhogam.
So, at the same time as Ambujamal, Janamal, Vaimukode Nayaki, all of them going into prison, there is also Shivabhogam who goes in along with them. And in 1931-32, when Shivabhogam is in prison, something occurs to her and she declares to Ambujamal that when I come out, I'm going to become a chartered accountant, or I'm going to become a government accountant, a GDA, government diploma in accounting or something like that. I'm going to write that exam. So comes out and works as an apprentice in a company called Sharma and Shah and Shastri, which is still there in Armenian Street, and then writes the GDA examination and qualifies in it, only to discover that the government has got a rule that if you have been imprisoned, you cannot practice as an independent accountant. Challenges the law in the courts and waits for 7 years for the judgment to come. And finally, the judgment is that imprisonment is no bar for practicing independently. Now, she could have easily sat at home. Somebody would have taken care of her brothers or somebody like that, but chose not to. Fought for it, became India's first woman chartered accountant, became one of the leading members of the Southern Regional Council of Indian Chartered Accountants, wore khadi throughout her life, and traveled only by bus, because she believed that that was the method of transport for Indians, and dealt with several companies as a chartered accountant. I mean, it's just amazing, that kind of guts. And Durgabai's guts in the end, you know, finally discovering at the end of her life that the husband is dead, the first husband is dead. The woman whom she married to the first husband is now on bad days, brings her home and takes care of her till her death. And then discovers that Chintaman Deshmukh was married to an English woman several years earlier, had a daughter from her called Gigi, and there is no contact between Gigi and her father. Works to establish contact between that girl and Chintaman Deshmukh, and then reunites the two of them. So there is a much softer side as well. And in the end, you know, both Chintaman and Durgabai became such challenges to the Nehruvian notion of popularity that they had to be dismissed, because they could have become Prime Minister and First Lady or something else. So Chintaman resigned and Durgabai was summarily dismissed as chairman of the Central Social Welfare Board overnight. Next day goes to office to find the doors are locked and is told you don't have to come any longer. So this is what politics can do.
And still can do. I just have to put this in context. Just imagine that there was the British had just come out of an era of Victorian morality, where under Queen Victoria, even the legs of the piano had to be covered to be decent. And then you had the momentum of the Indian independence movement, Gandhiji, who had really triggered the latent power of women all over India to throw in their lot with the nation's freedom. So these women must have been really terrible thorns in the British flesh.
Absolutely.
I mean, they wouldn't have ever expected that that they would
certainly
have persisted and done what they could have.
You know, for that matter, Annie Besant, the famous story that, you know, when she was arrested and then sent to Ootacamund and then was released on grounds of ill health and had to go to London. So goes and meets Lord Chelmsford, the Viceroy, and says, now that I am allowed to leave the country, do you think I'll be allowed to come back? And then he says, well, Mrs. Besant, we've got you out with great difficulty. Do you think we are going to be in any hurry to get you back into this nation? So this was the standard opinion about women. You know, as long as they were not troublesome, they were meant to be seen.
Yes.
And not to be heard and not to express their opinion under any circumstance. Everything was fine then.
So now we've heard about these women with great nobility, courage, guts, determination, chutzpah, whatever. But it's getting to be a little too predictable. Now we need to know about some scandal.
No, but we must not forget E.V. Kalyani, the one,
yes,
whom I told you about.
Yes. This next name, I think every second person in this city must have been delivered by her hands. Dr. E.V. Kalyani.
Yes. Now, see, we've seen cases where the husband was indifferent, the husband went mad, the husband was supportive, there was no husband, husband was married off to someone else. Now we have the case of a father, Dr. E.V. Srinivasan, the well-known eye surgeon and a fairly rough and tough man. Apparently, if you went to him and said, "Kanna arikirde, seri pudingi eduthudren, anju nimisham angave paduthukonga," that was the kind of response that he would give. Now, he, the apple of his eye, is widowed, Kalyani, his young daughter. And the family does not like it that Kalyani should be educated to become a doctor. Dr. Srinivasan chooses to break away from the family and says that for in the interests of my daughter's well-being and education, I will break contact with all of you because I don't think you are important in this context. and then educates her and ensures that she becomes a pioneering gynecologist. And several tough gynecologists have come about from that fold later. I remember Sharda, my wife, went to one and kept complaining to my mother-in-law. My mother-in-law said, "This is nothing. You must have seen E.V. Kalyani in her prime." So Kalyani was a tough gynec, but I think she was a pioneering gynec and is a name worth commemorating till today, you know. And
yes, absolutely. In fact, many of these women are now just remembered by the names of streets in our city. And I hope that this discussion will provoke some of your interest, but I want to come back to
Except
women of
JJ
scan.
Road, which is not after JJ, incidentally, but
JJ.
After the JJ axis of the development of Kasturi Estate. That's about it.
JJ so, Road, make a note, not after the JJ. So can we come to women of scandal? Yeah. I said angelic assassins.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So we've had gold diggers as well, like any other society.
Yes.
So if you look at this woman called Sita Devi of Baroda, she comes from our own Alvarpet. There is a road there called Maharani Chinnamma Road, which currently is being interpreted differently. But actually, it is Maharani Chinnamamba Road. So it's Maharani Chinnamamba Road, not after a snake or anything like that. But Chinnamamba was the mother of Sita Devi, the Maharani of Pittapuram, and Surya Rao Road goes on the other side. Sita Devi was sensationally beautiful, married to the Zamindar of Ujuru, located in Madras, living happily, but one day on the Madras race course, meets the Maharaja of Baroda, Pratap Singh Rao Gaikwar, and then decides that this is the man, because he's a 21 gun salute state man, he's got a carpet of pearls, he's got the famous Baroda 7-string necklace, the Eugenie diamond, he's made of wealth. So decides to get married to him. And so, you know, the Baroda rules do not allow for the fact that you can marry a second wife if you are the ruling king. So he converts to Islam, Sita Devi becomes Ayesha, and then they get married and then they reconvert to Hinduism. So when the matter is challenged in court, the lawyers argue that at the time of the wedding, our Maharaja was not the Maharaja. He was only a Muslim subject of our state. Then the first wife, Shanta Devi, is still around with a brood of children. But Sita Devi has a son, and then the couple vanish to Monte Carlo and Monaco and places like that. And that's where they live. But by then, independence is coming around, and they have to deal with this formidable adversary called Vallabhai Patel. And he decides that if the Maharaja is not coming back by a particular date, Shanta Devi will be made the Regent Maharani, the first wife. And then they begin to make a tally of all that is missing, and they find the Eugenie diamond is gone, the 7-string pearl necklace is gone, the pearl carpet has vanished, everything is vanished and is probably now somewhere in Paris or wherever. And then Sita Devi promptly divorces Pratap Singh Rao Gaikwad and lives happily ever after in Paris for the rest of her life. All on the Baroda fortunes, everything begun from Alvarpet right over here.
Another woman.
We must finish, I think, with
yes.
Rambai.
Rambai.
Rambai is our last character.
Yes.
There is nothing known about Rambai. All that we know is that there was a North Indian sate who came down to Madras in 1865, a man called Baladin. And he had several gold jewels on his person. What he was doing wearing them, I have no idea. But Rambai, also being from North India, they live in Saukarpet. She and her family, they make friends with Mr. Baladin. And one fine morning, Mr. Baladin vanishes. Nobody knows where he's gone. That particular year was a very good year for our city because we had only 5 murders. So the police had a lot of time to investigate the absence of Mr. Baladin. So police constable Roop Ram is put on the task of identifying where Baladin has vanished. And finally, he finds the body hidden, burnt in a chowl tree. Half hidden, half burnt, and then he begins his investigations and finds that his jewels are all now with Rambai. So Rambai has basically engineered the murder of Mr. Baladin. 5 people are arrested. One of them turns approver. Rambai is let off because of her gender. 4 people, including her husband, are hanged. She is present at the time of the hanging, and after the hanging comes over to Roop Ram and says, "I have something to tell you." And he says, "What?" She says, "You know, the worst of the group you never apprehended." And he is still alive somewhere and then walks away forever. So this, we've had characters like that as well in our city.
And many more characters, I'm sure. So what you've heard now with this amazing raconteur is, I think, as a dancer, all the Navarasas, including Vatsalya, Bibatsa, Hasya, Adbhuta, Veera, everything. Thank you so much, Sriram, for this very, very, very engaging conversation where you made my responsibility very, very easy. Now we do have a few minutes for questions. We're very good on time. So yes, mics, everybody, hands are up.
Yeah. To describe so poignantly the torture of child marriage and other practices, if you just go back 75 years in time, we had a practice called Sati, which was abolished by Ram Mohan Roy and William Bentinck. Compared to that, this is a progress, is it not? From Sati to child marriage.
I don't know. I do not know whether getting burnt instantaneously is any better than being married to a man who's got four wives and who's capable of dying any time on you and leaving you a widow. So I do not want to express an opinion on that.
Okay, my question is, how did the society accept these women? Like, obviously we're talking about, especially the female population, they are thought to be subjugated, like they are thought to be not dominant and all. And these women have made a professional and a social mark. So how did society accept these people?
I have a feeling that society reacted very negatively when each one of them, for instance, if you look at Sister Subbalakshmi, when Sister Subbalakshmi started her widow's home and later it was shifted to the ice house, the people of Triplicane conducted a fire sacrifice praying that the sea should rise and come and swallow the ice house, because it was a house of sin, because widows were being kept over there and they were being encouraged to lead a new life. So I think this was the kind of reaction that people like Sister Subbalakshmi faced when they set out. And there is the other story of Sister again, when she opted to join the Presidency College in Madras as a student. Every day in the morning, she would leave before sunrise from home in a Sakai rickshaw holding an umbrella so that nobody can see that she is on her way to college. Because if they saw her, they used to stand outside and shout abuse, saying that a widow is going to get educated. And when she stood first, they said she had slept with all the professors, which is how she had managed to get her marks. So I think this is how society reacted. When Saraswati Bai became the first Harikatha performer, they wrote a letter to her. Her guru was teaching in the Madras Christian College as a Sanskrit professor. A letter was sent to the college saying that he's got immoral relations with this girl and he's promoting her career. You should dismiss him immediately from this place. So that is how I think we reacted. I don't think we reacted in any good fashion.
Good morning. How did he add Sita Devi as a great lady? She's just a
interesting characters. That's about it. It is not nobility.
Okay.
As much in the Navarasas, you have Bhivatsam also, as you get disgusted by certain things. You could also have certain amount of envy. She married a Maharaja and lived happily. So
I want to know if any of these ladies who got rid of their husbands or whatever had the boldness to live with another man while they were still young.
That's a very, very good question. And I am not able to... I would perhaps put KB Sundarambal as the only example in that category, because KBS, as we all know, came from a life where, you know, the mother was very poor and... We do have some time, I think, so I can elaborate a little on this. So, you know, the mother was exceedingly poor and at one stage had taken all the children to be drowned in the river, because she didn't know where the next meal was going to come from. And KBS was the eldest, but not more than 6 or 7 at that time, apparently kept asking the mother, what is it that we are going to the river for? And the mother finally broke down and told her that I'm going to kill all of you and jump into the river at the end. And I believe KBS said, don't worry, we'll find a way, do not kill any of us, and brought them all back. So this was the guts. Then ran a drama troupe by herself and finally did not marry S.G. Kittappa but lived with him. But also acknowledged that every time on stage she upstaged S.G. Kittappa, she knew that on getting back home he would beat her black and blue under the influence of alcohol. But still considered him to be her lawfully wedded husband. And when he died of abuse, naturally, considered herself a widow and wore only white thereafter. So there is an instance of that as well.
Sriram, who's your inspiring person?
Sharada Sriram, who's in the audience.
Apart from Sharada, apart from your grandmother and Sister Subbalakshmi.
Oh, all of them. All of them. See, because I, you know, every time I read about these lives, and I think I've spent a lot of time reading women's biographies more than the... Because I find that you get different colors from it, which you rarely get from... One of my favorite bedtime reading is this Women Writing in India, which is a two-volume compilation by Susi Tharu and Lalita, which kind of compiles the writing of women from starts almost from Andal, and then comes right down to the modern times. There is a phenomenal amount of color, and there is a lot of frankness in the... See, if Tyagaraja had been a Miss Tyagaraja, I think we would have had a very colorful biography of the man and not this horrible hagiography that we now live with, that he got up in the morning and then Rama came to him, then he went to shave, Rama came to him, he had breakfast, Rama came to him, then he went to the temple, Rama came to him. Now, this is not the Tyagaraja himself. In his songs, doesn't appear to be so boring as the way we have made him out to be. So we have a great penchant for making lives very, very boring and very glorified. Ayyo, avar appadila irundadhe kedaiyadhu. But our parents told him to naalu kudumbam enik irke adu eppadi appdin ketta adellam eppinga adellam thappu. This is a kind of thing. So I would say that, yeah, please.
Shivam uncle, something about Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay.
See, now I have become uncle. Such is the tragedy of life. So
something about Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay.
I wish I knew a little more about her, but I haven't. I do know that she worked a lot for the handicrafts and all that. Chandralekha is much later. Chandralekha could stand on the shoulders of several others, of several women who had laid the foundation for what went on afterwards. I think she comes from a generation when the Prime Minister was a woman, several ministers had, were women and things like that. So I would not classify Chandralekha in this genre of pioneering women who really kind of struggled and tried to make a name for themselves. So, in fact, I would include women like Patama, Subbalakshmi, Brinda, Mukta. I would bring all of them into the first category of the women who, for instance, in the Tyagaraja Aradhana and Thiruvayaru, it was the story of Nagaratnama is very well documented. I'm not going into that. But Nagaratnama having died, having established everything, for years it was still compulsory that only men would conduct the Unchavritti for Tyagaraja. That is the ritual singing of Tyagaraja songs and seeking alms before the final celebration of his life. Only men could do it. But one afternoon, when it was going to start, Brindamma held Muktamma's hand and M.S. Subbalakshmi's hand and said, "Let's go." And they never said a word. They just joined in the singing. And not one fellow could say anything about it. Until today, women join the Unchavritti and they continue singing. So, I would say that in small ways, or M.S. Soundaram, who was a very less known musician of the early years, and when she chose to be a single woman, having decided that her husband was no good, and the legend, at least in our family, was that when she found her mother-in-law to be intolerable, picked up 2 teaspoons of chili powder and pressed it on the mother-in-law's eyes and then left the house forever, and then decided to lead a life independently as a music teacher, and used to teach all the aristocratic families of Trichy. Now, wherever she went to teach, an anonymous letter would follow. Pattukari Saundari Uru Vyapachari. She is a whore. You cannot keep her in your employment. People who rose above that continued giving her, opportunities to earn money by teaching children. But very few did. So it was a life of great struggle. So I would say that these were the great pioneers.
I just want to end with a note. I know we somehow came into talking about performing artists. But this is the year of the birth centenary of 2 remarkable women, Bala Saraswati and Ambujam Krishna. So once again, thank you, Sriram. Thank you for being a wonderful audience. And thank you to the Hindu Lit Fest.